that promise, believing that what you have said is yea and amen, that you keep your word. So if you do keep your word, and we challenge you on that, then Father, as I look around the sanctuary, I see more than two or three. I see hundreds of people gathered together with one heart and one mind and one desire and one mission, and that is to lift the name of Jesus high.
Yes, yes, yes.
So we're asking you, God, to have your way as we declare that no one else deserves glory. No one else can receive the praise. No one else can receive the honor, because you're holy and righteous. You're omnipotent. You're mighty. You're Alpha. Yes, you are Omega. You're our Redeemer and our Savior in the name of Jesus. And we pray, amen, amen, and amen, and amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now you can stay on your feet if you would. Stay on your feet if you would. I believe behind you, is this dynamic praise? Is this dynamic praise? So we got some dynamic praise on us. And I believe we got here as well. Put your hands together. Would you put your hands together, yeah? Here we go. No one else can receive the glory.
Just
answer.
Did he wake you up this morning? Ain't nobody but Jesus. Hey! Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Yes, God.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. The reason why no one else deserves to receive the glory is because I heard someone say it like this. I was in a refugee camp in France, Dunkirk, France. The man who was interpreting for us to a recently converted Muslim said, Muhammad is dead. He said, Buddha is dead. And this recently converted Muslim started to shake his head like this when he said, the only prophet that lives is the prophet. His name is Yeshua, Jesus Christ. So if you believe with us that Jesus Christ is coming again, can we sing about the return of the King? Hymn number 213. He's coming again.
Echoing hilltops. Echoing.
he's coming back because he thought I was worth saving. Jesus thought I was worth purchasing. Jesus thought I was worth dying for. Anybody in the building glad that Jesus thought you were worth it? Anybody in the building happy that Jesus came from heaven? Come on, let's sing it together. You thought I was.
You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping.
You filled me up inside.
So you cleaned me up inside.
Yeah. Whatever burden that they had, Lord, that you will deliver them from whatever burden they have, Lord. We have come, Lord, because we need a word from you. We have come, Lord, because we need to be revived. We have come, Lord, because we need a touch from you, Heavenly Father. So whatever ministers out there, Lord, stretch your hand and touch them, Lord. Touch them in a way that no one can touch them, Lord. Bless them, Lord. Bless our service. Let everything that we do in this sanctuary, Lord, be to your glory and your glory alone. Let man not be praised, but let you, God, deserve it, because you deserve the praise. And when everything is said and done, we will be careful to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let me see them.
Well, if you love the Lord and you're in this place today, why don't you go ahead, lift your hands towards heaven and shout hallelujah. Somebody who's glad that Jesus died for you, come on, lift your hands and say thank you, Jesus. Psalmist said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And it is my honor, my privilege to welcome you to our Monday evening worship experience. Have we not had a mountaintop experience since starting on last night? on last night, Elder Kennedy Luckett took our souls toward the throne of grace. On this morning, Pastor Jason Ridley took us a little bit higher with Nighttime is the Right Time. We were then further blessed at 12:30 with the preaching of Dr. Rudolph McKissick. God, did he preach till times got better? And then at 5 o'clock, Pastor Donovan Washington took our souls just a little bit higher. And I guarantee that we are in tonight for a special word from the Lord through his manservant. He'll be introduced a little bit later. Just for a quick second or two, why don't you just turn to the person next to you? Maybe you don't know him. Go ahead and tell him, I'm glad to see you in the house of God tonight. Tell him your name if you don't know him. Amen. Praise God, praise God. We're very blessed on this evening to have with us Mrs. Carmela Monk, who is the editor of Message Magazine. Message Magazine is our magazine. What do you say, church? Message Magazine is our magazine. What do you say, church? And so we're so proud of what Mrs. Monk is doing, and she's going to come before us at this time in her own special way. Let's give her a warm PELC welcome as she comes to share with us.
Thank you, Pastor Brissette. Good evening, PELC. Good evening. It is so wonderful to come and stand before you on behalf of Message Magazine, our magazine that we are so proud of, that God has preserved and given us this ministry and blessed us to be able to share with other people. Message, if you look at it, I don't know if I have that slide up there. Message, you see that little subliminal image that we put in there in the logo? You see that little cursor point? Because message is the tip of the spear. Message is the entering wedge. Message is that foot in the door with the people that you're trying to share Christ with. Message Magazine. I want you to take a look at something really quick. I don't know if they have that video.
Meet them where they look closely. You'll see someone who needs to be reached. In everything, be Christ-like and social. Engage your community and explore your world. Meet them where they are because they may never seek him on their own. Find someone to win and share the message.
Message Magazine is not just still here. We're alive and kicking, and we are making improvements every day so that you can be able to share Message Magazine with the friends and the family that you know, easy at your fingertips. You can send it. You can sign up for the app on Google Play or the iTunes Store. I want you to know that we live in sobering times, and we're grateful to be in this ministry, to stand in this place, to share the love of Christ with people who do not know. We're not just standing in sobering times here close to the end. There's a certain group of people who are feeling it more than other people. Am I right? There's a certain group of people who understand what it's like to be the subject of an everyday microaggression. You know what that's like. When you walk down the street and somebody holds their purse closer to themselves, right? You know what that's like when somebody locks the door when you're there. Microaggressions, you know what it's like when somebody passes along a micro invalidation where it's all in your head. They didn't mean that. Or it's not racist, you're just too sensitive. So we've gone from microaggressions and micro invalidations to flat out full frontal aggression. To flat out full frontal invalidation, as we saw today, as they had a mistrial in the Walter Scott. Did you see that today? Video in hand, shot in the back, completely invalidated the life of Walter Scott. We cannot find the shooter guilty. What am I trying to say? We have a wonderful opportunity to let people know To God, you matter. He cares about your life. He cares about your finances. He cares about your well-being. He cares about your mental state. And he's coming back and he has a promise for you in your life. That's what we're doing with Message Magazine. It's not for us. It's for the people around us. So here's what I'm gonna ask you to do today. Your magazine needs you. Your magazine needs you to support it by taking out a subscription yourself. Your magazine needs you to get the app, messagemagazine.com, or the app. Your magazine needs you to become a sustaining member of this ministry, Message Magazine. Our theme this year is Find Someone to Win. There's somebody around you that you know, your hairdresser, your neighbor, your friend on Facebook that you used to go to school with. It's your opportunity to share the message. Find someone to win.
How many of you have been blessed by the music all conference long? We are so thankful for Pastor Chandler and the worship team, the Aeolians. And on tonight, we have just as good a choir as there is anywhere. And so would you help me appreciatively applaud the ministry and the gift of Dynamic Praise as they come to minister to us in their own special way. Come on, you can do better than that. These young people have been serving and sacrificing through their finals to come and minister to and for us. Let's support them as they come. Thank you.
Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. One of the things that the enemy does, he always tries to lie to the saints of God. Because the essence of who he is that he is the father of lies. And when you're going through a storm, I don't know about you, but there are times when all of us go through storms. He will convince you that God does not see you in your situation. But because you went to Oakwood and you recognize that God is a God who sees all, you recognize that he lies and that God, the great God of heaven that we know and we appreciate, he sees you in your situation. And so the devil says, well, I can't get him on that. So he convinces you or tries to convince you that God may see you in your situation, but that God does not care about you, that he's a God too busy. He's a God too busy to really be involved in your little T90 business. But because you know that God not only sees, but he does care, you say, the devil, you are a liar. And so the devil tries one more thing. He says, yeah, you know I was just playing. God does see. God does care. But really, God does not have the power to do anything to fix your circumstance. But I want you to understand that we serve a God who really knows how to adjust every situation perfectly. I wonder if I had two or three witnesses to know that when you are down, that God can lift you up. I wonder if I had three or four of you who knows that God knows how to pick us up and turn it around and place our feet back on solid ground. If you know that I know that you know and we know all together that we serve a God that can handle your case, I want you to just come down the aisle because we're getting ready to pray. Because prayer changes things. And not only changes things, but changes people. If you need a circumstance to be turned around, I'm going to ask that you join me at the altar. Because I've been asked to stand in the gap between the preachers, the workers, and an almighty God, because he's able to turn it around. How many of you know he's able? Standing, grab hold of somebody's hand next to you. Father, oh Father, we come tonight declaring your awesomeness. Oh God, our Father, you are our strong tower. You are a rock in the weary land. Oh God, you are our shelter in the time of storm. And so we come tonight not with any fancy words, but we just want to say, Lord, you worthy to be praised. And Lord, we want to praise you because of the fact that praise is only due you. Because you are God who spoke and it was done. A God who commands and it stands still. Lord, we've come from many places around the globe. But we're coming in this place because, Lord, we need a touch from you. Oh, God, I thank you for your mercy. Matter of fact, out of all the things that I love about you, I know for myself that you're a God of another chance. And so I thank you today for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your keeping power. Can't nobody do us like you can, God. So you have allowed us to come together one more time. And so we thank you tonight. You thought we were enough, that we are worth saving. So you sacrificed your life. And so, oh God, I just want to just spend just a few moments on our feet, on our knees, in prayer tonight, because I just simply want to say thank you. Oh Lord, you're worthy to be thanked tonight. I thank you, oh God, for our life. Because whether we know it or not, we are only one heartbeat away from death. And so we recognize that you alone and you alone are the only one who sustains us in life. I thank you tonight for your word, oh God, because the world is in darkness, but your word is our light. And so tonight, we thank you for your word tonight. I thank you, oh God, tonight for your salvation, oh God, because it was your amazing grace that took us from where we are in the darkness of sin. But you, Lord, you allowed the blood of Jesus Christ to come into our lives so that we can have another chance. And so we wave our hands, not because we deserve to wave our hands, but because of your grace tonight, you have allowed us another chance. I thank you tonight, not only for life, not only for your word, not only for your salvation, but I thank you for your blessings, oh God. Lord, you have blessed us. We have been blessed through and through tonight, and I'm so glad about your blessings. But oh God, I even thank you tonight for the trials that you allowed to come into our lives that only come to make us strong. So sometimes it's hard to be thankful for trials, but by faith we know that you are a loving God, and we can rejoice tonight even in our tribulations. And so we know that all things will work together for our good to those who are called and who love the Lord according to the purpose.
So thank you, Lord, for the trials. We thank you, Lord, for the things that we go through that only come to make us strong. I thank you tonight for the land of freedom, even in the midst of uncertainty, even in the midst of injustice, even in the midst of those things and crimes. Oh God, we're just thankful that we tonight can just sit unfiltered, and we can come tonight declaring your goodness in this land of freedom. And so Lord, we want to be big enough even to pray for the leadership of this land. And so, Lord, right now, we're asking that you would intervene and that you will even have your way in our next president. And so we claim that you still have the power to do whatever you need to do to adjust things perfectly. But, oh, God, we're thankful not only for all of the things we're thankful for, but we're thankful for that blessed hope. Because lift up the trumpet. And loud let it ring. We know that soon and very soon we're going to see the King. So Lord, right now, somebody here is sick, lying on their hospital bed. Somebody right here is at home, assigned to their bed of affliction. But we know tonight that you're still Jehovah Rapha, your Lord that heals. So we declare right now, Satan, you take your dirty hands off that sick person, off that family situation, off that marriage, off that church that is full of devilish things. And we declare victory tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, let your glory be revealed tonight. And so, Lord, those of us who are down, lift us up. We pray, oh God, for a purpose and a vision to last us through these last days. But lastly, oh God, I pray for the preacher tonight. Lord, we know that Dr. Carter is here with a word from on high. Lord, as you have blessed the other preachers, we're asking that you would just dip him down in the wells of your word. Let the Spirit of God just pour down on him. Give us tonight a word that will transform us from where we are to where we deserve in your grace to be. And when you come, oh God, help us all to be found faithful. And we declare it in the matchless and mighty name that is above every name. At that name that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that you are King of Kings, that you are Lord of Lords. So Lord, take us, break us if you must, but with your divine and loving hands, put us back together again in Jesus' matchless and mighty name. If you love the Lord, somebody put your hands together and receive. Come on, come on, come on. Don't pity Pat God. Come on, don't pity Pat God. God can and will turn it around.
I would like to take the opportunity at this time to introduce to some and to present to others one of the greatest voices in gospel music. From songs like He Can Do the Impossible to Standard, one of the unmistakable voices of the group Witness, then branching out to a solo career where she has just continued to grow and to impact and to minister under the anointing of God across the length and breadth of the country and, yeah, even the world. You all remember her from Open Praise. You all remember her from the Works. Tonight, we introduce to you and present to some Mrs. Lisa Page Brooks, who will minister to us this evening. Mrs. Brooks, we're glad to have you here at PELC. We thank you for making this journey, and we're looking forward to what God is going to do through you to minister to us. And so at this time, without further ado, would you help me welcome Mrs. Lisa Page Brooks? Let's give her a warm PELC welcome as she comes.
Your hands can give God praise.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you can do better. Some of you all look, that's cute if you're clapping for me, but I need you to clap for your Lord. Isn't he amazing? What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. I'm honored to be here all this evening. To everyone responsible, God bless you. Thank you. I don't take it lightly. God is so faithful, and any opportunity I have to minister, I praise God for that. How many really love the Lord tonight? I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. And let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. I love you, Lord. Do you really love the Lord tonight? And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. And what you hear, and let it be a sweet sound, and let it be a sweet sound, and let it be somebody. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh, my Lord. Can you clap your hands and praise him? We exalt thee. We exalt. Bless your name, my Lord. Oh, my Lord, I lift you high, my Lord. Oh, my Lord, I praise your name, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. I need somebody to praise God in here. I need the praises to ring. Oh, my Lord, we lift you high, my Lord. Tonight, y'all. He is my Lord. You gotta know him for yourself, yeah. My Lord. You gotta know him for yourself, y'all. You, my Lord. Some of y'all looking like y'all don't know him. If you know him, praise him.
My Lord.
Just put your hands on yourself. He is my Lord. Say, tell somebody he's my Lord. I can call him in the midnight hour. He's my Lord. He's my Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Bless you, Jesus. And for this, we are thankful. Amen. Come on, clap your hands if you're thankful. Bless you. Just lift your hands and say, Lord, I thank you. Come on, somebody say, Lord, I thank you. Hallelujah. Yee. For every time that you protected me when I did not know your name.
Lord, I say thank you.
How you loved on me and cared for me when I didn't return the same.
Lord, I say thank you.
Now when flood and lifted me above, and
I'm gonna say thank
you.
I'll be praising you for the rest of
I said, all of my. Yes, Lord. Everything you do, and I want to say for how you kept your hand upon me, though I'd often gone astray, and
Lord, I say thank you.
And how your spirit gently led me back to safety in your way.
I gotta say
thank you.
I gotta say thank you. Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for saving.
I want to say.
Tonight for the blood, amen. How many know his blood? Somebody say it's working right now. I need you to tell somebody the blood is working right now. Ah, come on, choir.
Now for me. of sin. His blood cleanses me deep down within. If you ask me how I made it and how I've overcome, all that I can tell you is because of the blood.
Blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus.
Oh, 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 the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus. Talking about the blood of Jesus.
let's put our hands together and thank God for the blood, the blood, the blood that still works. Praise the Lord. Let's thank God again for our newest and best friend, Lisa Paige Brooks. We thank God. This has been a tremendous day. I want to, just by way of announcement, this is an announcement for the conference secretaries. In the Mosley Chapel, Secretary Nixon and all of the chaplains on my mind. You know, as a matter of fact, we have been blessed, and this is the very first time that we've done it, to have a number of chaplains from different disciplines worshiping with us and working with us. Let's put our hands together for all of the chaplains. Amen? What I meant was the secretaries. The secretaries, conference secretaries, are meeting in the Mosley Chapel immediately after this service tonight. This has been an amazing day. I can't remember too many days like this. As a matter of fact, we've had some incredible nights over the last 5-6 years. Monday night is our community night. And we want to share with everybody that we are brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen? We had William Houston Curtis, and when he first preached, we didn't have no plants. But then after he preached, we thought we need to put some plants up here to keep the brothers from coming up. Come on, say amen. But after the day, we're going to put up an electric chain fence. I didn't hear nobody talk to me. My. Since 1990, he has been the senior pastor of the Calvary Baptist Church in Morristown, New Jersey. He's a graduate of Drew University of Princeton Theological Seminary, and he has a PhD in liturgical studies with an emphasis on homiletics. I know what I'm talking about. He has presented to us a number of times at the Hampton Ministers Conference, and the first time we heard him as a facilitator, as a teacher. But you know, it's always a little preaching in the teacher. Come on, say amen. And he blessed our hearts tremendously the night that he taught at Hampton. And then from that point, we've heard him preach on a number of occasions. He is a teacher of preachers. He understands the dynamic of preaching. He knows the power of preaching. He knows the mystery and the spirituality of preaching. And he also knows this. He knows that preachers need preaching. Y'all missed what I just said, so I'm going to say that one more time. Preachers need preaching. Sometimes people scratch their heads because we come here to celebrate the goodness of God. We come here for the fellowship that we experience one with the other. But we also come here with shared knowledge of the challenges that face us when we go back home. And so I think I reflect the heart of so many preachers and pastors. I come here to shout. Come on, say it. I came here to shout because God's been good to me. So we celebrate God through the preachers and the singers from night to night. The Lord has been good to us. Our preacher is a phenomenal gift to the body of Christ, and we celebrate him tonight. Preacher, we know that God is going to help you. And we're going to help you preach too. To God be the glory. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Jerry Carter. Let's put our hands together. Hear ye him.
Thank you. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you afresh for the total sufficiency of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for this gathering. Thank you for the fact that the blood still works and that there is a fountain filled with that blood that still works. Pray now that you would bless us with preaching power, purpose, and productivity. Move some stuff out the way. Create some space in us. Somebody brought some baggage tonight, Lord, that may prevent the profitable and productive hearing of your word. So move some stuff out the way and break up the fallow ground. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, this is the day the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in this day. Well, let's try that again. This is the day the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in this day. A friend of mine says that if God has grace enough to make the day, you ought to have sense enough to rejoice and be glad in this day. To conference chair, Dr. Wilson, and to host pastor, Dr. Bird, and to all of you, my sisters and brothers in the Lord, good evening. I greet you in the name of Christ Jesus, who is alive and well on tonight. I'm glad to be here, not because I have so much to say, but just to see what's going on here. This is all right. This is all right. Yeah. I've heard about this. A couple of my friends who've been through here have told me about this. And the half has not been told as to what the Lord is doing in this gathering. And I think we ought to give God glory just for what God is doing. I want to thank those responsible for the invitation to come and be a part of your conference this year. The worship has been amazing, the music all the way around. You got to give me a second. I'm kind of overwhelmed, but I could play it off and just go right into what I want to say, but I'm trying to give this a chance to settle in. But we just serve an amazing God, and God is doing, we're living in the midst of times of craziness, but God is doing great things. And I'm glad to see that he's doing it here. Again, thank those responsible. Always blessed to have some familiar faces, some of my friends around me, Reverend LaRock Grosvenor and Anthony Riley and Marquise Johnson, some others who are here on tonight. Thank God for them. I want you to turn with me to the book of Exodus, chapter 33. Exodus chapter 33. And I want to begin reading at verse 18. Exodus 33:18. And I'm reading from the New International Version. You hear these words. Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you. I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But he said, "You can't see my face, for no one may see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my backside, but my face must not be seen. I want to talk about the backside of God. The backside of God. Backside of God. A few years ago, I was closing out revival in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And on the last night, the pastor had planned on taking myself and some of the others out to a nice restaurant for dinner after service was over. For 2 days, he had been bragging about how wonderful the food was at this place and the ambiance and how they had a nice patio outside. It was summertime, so we could go out there after we had eaten. And he told me about the entrees that he would typically get when he would go there. So after church is over, myself and a couple other visiting pastors attending the revival load up in the pastor's SUV, his fancy SUV. And I noticed that when we're about to take off, he puts the address of the restaurant into his navigation system. Strange to me, because I thought he had been there over and over again. And so I asked him, I said, now, if you've been there, why do you have to put the address into the navigation system? He said, yeah, I go there all the time. But you know me, and I'm a kind of a techno geek, and I just like the idea of this voice talking to me, helping me to get where I need to be. Well, I came to the conclusion that for him, guidance was a luxury, but it was not a necessity. When you get to Exodus chapter 33, for Moses, guidance was not a luxury, it was a necessity. Moses and the children of Israel had already covered a lot of ground. Yeah, they had crossed the Red Sea. They had journeyed through the desert of Shur. They have made it to the land of Elam, where they had 12 springs and 70 palm trees. They had traversed through the difficult desert of Sin, made it to Rephidim. They had to deal with the bitter waters of Marah. This was land that they had already covered. But as difficult as that land was to cover, for Moses, this was not new territory. Because Bible readers are acquainted with the fact that when Moses had to flee, after he had killed the Egyptian, that he makes his way to the Sinai Peninsula. Moses already knew what was between Egypt and Sinai. But by the time you get to Exodus chapter 33, it's now time for Moses to lead the people from Sinai to Canaan. He knew what Egypt to Sinai was, but he didn't know anything about Sinai to Canaan. One more time. He knew what the land was like between Egypt and Sinai. But now he had to go down the road less traveled. Now he had to go somewhere where he had never been before. And now guidance would not be a luxury. Guidance would be a necessity. See, it's easy to take God's guidance for granted when you keep on going down the same path. It's easy to take God's presence for granted when you keep doing the same thing and keep doing it the same way and you keep doing it in the same place. But when you decide to do something new, when you decide to go a new direction, that's when God's guidance is no longer a luxury. It's a necessity. Do I have a witness here? And many times in our churches and our ministries, sometimes we take God's presence for granted because we keep on going back and forth between Egypt and Sinai, never making the journey from Sinai to Canaan, because we get comfortable with the journey from Egypt to Sinai. But if you keep going from Egypt to Sinai, you never make it to the promised land. Somebody has said that the Holy Ghost could leave some of our churches and we wouldn't notice it. Because there's nothing that we're doing that requires the power of the Holy Ghost. But when you decide to do something different, look like I'm alone in here. When you decide to go down a different pathway, you can't help but to depend on the power of the Lord. Something happens when we get good at ministry. Something happens when we get good at preaching and singing. We no longer depend on the Lord like you did when you first started. You remember how it was when you first started preaching? You remember how it was when you first started ministering? You fasted and you prayed, but something happened. You got good at it. Somebody looking at me right now, you've been doing a whole lot of journeying, but your journeying has been between Egypt to Sinai. Maybe it's time for somebody to go from Sinai to Canaan, a place where you've never been, do something you've never done, with some folks you've never done it. Maybe it's time to make a different journey. And when you make a different journey, you will discover that God's guidance is not a luxury. It is a... Are you going to help me here tonight? It is a necessity. Moses was about to go somewhere where he had never been. And so what he does is he goes outside of the camp in chapter 33. And he makes his way to the tent of meeting. Because no matter how comfortable he is in the camp, he has to spend some time in the tent of meeting. When you're about to go somewhere you've never been, got to get away from the people. Got to get away from the cell phone. Get outside of the camp and spend some time with the Lord in the tent of meeting. That's where Moses goes. And when he gets there, God assures him that I will be with you. And after Moses hears that, Moses then makes tonight what I call a bold request. He says, Lord, show me your glory. Tonight, Lord, I need you to show me your glory. You've already promised me your presence. You've already promised us that you would lead us by a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. But that's what you're going to do for us tomorrow. But I need your glory tonight. I'm dealing with some stuff tonight that I've never dealt with. I'm having to face some stuff I've never faced. I need to see your glory tonight. Talk to me, Moses. Moses said, Lord, I need to see your glory. I need to see your Shekinah glory. I need to see your glory. That is your manifested presence. I need to see the overflow of your Shekinah glory. I need to see the reflection of who you are, because I'm headed somewhere where I've never been. And before I take off, before I deal with the people, I need to see the glory of God. Somebody ought to walk with me here, because somebody looking at me tonight, this ought to be your request. I want to see your glory. Lord, I've been on the mountaintop with you. I've received the Ten Commandments. Yeah, I've led the people across the Red Sea. But I never want my vocation to take the place of my devotion.
I never want to work for you to the point where I don't spend any time with you. Show me your glory. Lord, I've been preaching for 30 years. Lord, I've been pastoring for 10 years. I need to see something different on tonight. I need to see your glory because I'm about to go somewhere one more time where I've never been. Talk to me, Moses. Moses said, this is what I need because I know God. But the more I know him, the more I want to know him. And I want to know tonight, do you want more of God? I don't want to know, do you want more preaching assignments? I don't want to know, do you want more members on tonight? Do you want more of God? Oh, tonight our mindset ought to be the mindset of the psalmist. Oh, yeah, who said one thing have I desired of the Lord. That will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. Oh, our mindset ought to be that of the psalmist who said, as the deer pants after the water, so pants my soul after you. Oh, our mindset ought to be the mindset of the Apostle Paul, who after plenty of years of ministering for Christ and ministering with Christ, who said, that I might know him. Help me, Holy Ghost. And the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. A.W. Tozer says that the soul's paradox of love is to have found God but still seeking. That to have found God, that it developed a thirst in me. Come on, help me preach this thing. That somehow or another, the more I know of God, the more I want to know about God. Moses said, show me your glory. And what's strange on tonight, stay with me. I'm on my way to where I want to be. The strange thing about this tonight is that Moses, he doesn't just ask for God's glory, but he almost tells God that I want to see your glory. He makes this bold request on tonight. And the God who had been commanding him, he's now commanding that God. Show me your glory. He said, and the only reason that Moses could make this bold request is because he had shared an intimate relationship with God. Your intimacy with God gives you audacity in prayer. Come on, help me here. That I said your intimacy with God. You can't just ask God anything if you haven't been intimate with God. You will allow your children and your grandchildren to come to you and make bold requests that you won't allow a strange child to make because the intimacy gives them audacity. When you've been spending time in the presence of the Lord, you can go to him in boldness. You can go to him with bold requests. Moses said, I've been on a mountaintop with you, Lord. Now I'm in the valley. I need you to show me. Anybody want to see his glory on tonight? I says, anybody here who wants to see his glory on tonight? Anybody here about to face something that you've never faced? You need to make sure before you do it that you see the glory of the Lord. Show me your glory. Moses' bold request. Watch it. Here it is. All that was for free. Here it is. Moses' bold request is met with a necessary reassurance. The Lord says, okay, Moses, you want to see my glory? He said, I'm going to pass by. I'm not going to tarry with you for a long time. I'm not going to tabernacle with you for a long time. But I am going to pass by. You won't be able to possess who I am. You will be able to enjoy who I am for a little while. But I'm passing by, and what you have to understand is that when it comes to the presence of the Lord, we can't manufacture God's presence. Nor can you manipulate God's presence. When God's presence is in the house, you have to get into it while it's there. You can't take it from when God's presence is in the house. That's not the time for you to be texting when God's presence is in the house. That's not the time for me to be thinking about what I'm doing when church is over, because I don't know the next time that God is going to be in the house. So while he's in the house, I need to go ahead and get into his presence. While he's in the house, I need to appreciate the moment, because you cannot manufacture God's presence. He said, I'm going to pass by. I'm coming through Oakwood on tonight. I might not be here for a long time, but while I'm here, I need you to attach yourself to my presence. And I'm all right with God passing by. Can I tell you why? Because his passing is sometimes enough. I said his passing is, I need about three witnesses here, that his passing is enough. Come here, Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus said, I climbed up in the sycamore tree, and all he did was pass by in my city, and I was able to come down, and he saved me. And come here, Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus said, all he did was pass by Jericho. Passed through Jericho. He passed by long enough for me to cry, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And he blessed me with 20. Come here, woman who had the issue of blood. I didn't spend time at his feet for a long time. As he was passing, I touched the hem of his garment, and I was made whole of his plague. Is there anybody here tonight who knows that there's something about his passing? He's passing through here right now. I said, he's passing through here right now, and somebody's being blessed. Somebody's being lifted. Somebody's experiencing a breakthrough because his passing is enough. He says, Moses, I'm going to pass by. Can I tell you why his passing is enough? It's because his passing is productive. His passing is productive because his passing is always pregnant. He says, Moses, I'm going to be passing by, and as I'm passing by, I'm going to give birth to some triplets. look like I'm preaching by myself here. As I'm passing by, see, God never shows up empty-handed. Whatever God has comes with him when he's there. Somebody ought to help me here. So, if he has grace, that comes with him. Come on, if he has hope, that comes with him. Whatever God has comes with him. He says, Moses, when I pass by, you're going to be blessed with a few things. First of all, you're going to be blessed by my generosity. Because he said, all my goodness will pass in front of you. Goodness, that's the concrete expression of God's generosity. Do I have a witness here? God is never broke. When he comes by filled with all that he has, and he's able to drop something down on you. That's why Paul said, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. When God passes by, he always has something in his hand. He says, my passing is enough because of my generosity. He says, my passing is enough because when I come by, you're going to be blessed not just by my generosity, but also by my personality. He says, I will proclaim my name. And the name of God is the nature of God. So whoever God is in his name, he has to be in his nature. If his name is Jehovah Jireh, I'll preach in my own space, he has to provide. Because who he is in his name, he is in his nature. If he is Jehovah Shalom, he has to give you peace that passes all understanding, because that's who he is in his name. So that's who he is in his nature. That's why the Lord told Joseph, name that child Jesus, because he's going to save his people from their sins. When you know the name of God, you know the nature. I need some help here. Come here, Moses. Moses said, that's why before I went before the people, when the Lord told me to tell Pharaoh to let my people go, I looked at him and said, well, now, before I go, please tell me what your name is. Because if I know what your name is, then I know what you're going to do. And the Lord looked at him and said, well, now, if you had time, I'd tell you what all my names are. But let me just summarize it for you. If they ask you what my name is, just tell them that I am that I am. And everything that I need, they can find it in I am. Is there anybody here who knows that when you know the name of the Lord, you know the nature of him? Do you know what his name is? His name is Wonderful Counselor. His name is Mighty God. His name is Prince of Peace. His name is Everlasting Father. Touch your neighbor. Tell him, I know his name on tonight. His passing is enough. And I believe he's passing through here on tonight. He says, Moses, when I pass by, my passing is enough because you're going to be blessed with my generosity. You're going to be blessed with my personality. But you're also going to be blessed by my sovereignty. I love it. It's all right there. He said, because when I pass by, I'm going to have mercy on who I have mercy on. And whoever I have mercy on, me having mercy on them is more about me extending it than it is about them receiving it. And you can't determine who I'm going to have mercy on. And you can't get mad that I have mercy on somebody next to you. You can't get upset because I have mercy on somebody who you're mad at. And sometimes somebody you don't believe deserves God's mercy. I'm glad on tonight that God dispensing mercy is not up to people who are upset with me. God's mercy is not up to my neighbor. God says, I'm going to have mercy on who I'm going to have mercy on. So instead of me being mad that God is having mercy on somebody, I just ought to celebrate the fact that he's had mercy on me. If he hadn't had mercy on me, my seat would be empty on tonight. If he hadn't had mercy on me, the pulpit would be vacant on tonight. Am I looking at anybody here who knows that his mercy endures forever? When he passes by, he says, I will have mercy on who I have mercy on. I will have compassion on who I have compassion on. Moses comes with a bold request, and this bold request is met with the necessary reassurance. Watch this. But the necessary reassurance is qualified by God's partial revelation. Please wake up and hear me here. He says, I'm going to pass by. But now you got to understand that as I'm passing by Oakwood on tonight, I'm going to have to put you in a secure place. I'm going to have to put you on some stable ground, because in my passing, some stuff is going to be shaken up and you need to be on solid ground. He said, Moses, I'm going to pass by, but as I pass by, I'm going to set you in a cleft. And when I set you in a cleft, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cover your eyes. I'm going to cover your eyes with my hand. And I'm going to cover it long enough for me to get by you. God is talking anthropomorphically here, of course. That's the only way we know to talk of God. God doesn't have hands like we have hands. But there's the only way I know to talk about him. Anthropomorphism is an accommodation to our limitations. The only way I can talk about God is in my limited language. I'll preach for myself tonight. The only way I can talk about God is I have a God who has eyes and he can see. He has hands and he can touch. He has feet and he can get to me. He has arms and he can reach out to me. He says, I'm Moses, I'm going to cover your eyes. I'm going to cover your eyes, Moses, because whenever God shows up, God is revealed and concealed at the same time. I can't get help from right over here. He's revealed and concealed simultaneously. That's why you can never brag about how much you know about him. Because every time he reveals himself, he's also concealing himself. Oh, there's something about his presence. In the word of Rudolf Otto, that is characterized by a mysterium tremendum and mysterium fascinans. Mysterium fascinans means there's something about him that draws me. Mysterium tremendum means there's something about him that I can't get close to. So even when I get close to him, there's still something about him that I do not know. Because whenever God reveals himself, we don't know when to shout. He conceals himself and he reveals himself. Somebody ought to open up your mouth and just tell him thank you for the fact that I know what I do know. I may not know everything, but I know what I do know. I know he woke me up this morning. Somebody ought to bless his name. And I know he put running in my feet and clapping in my hands. He says, Moses, when I pass by, I'm going to cover your eyes until I get by. Once I get by you, then I'm going to take my hand off of you, because about that time, the only thing that will be visible to you is my backside. I don't want you to see me coming, because if you see me coming, you'll see my face. But I'm a blind you. I'm going to keep my hand on you until I get by you, because I need you to see my backside. Can I preach this thing here? The backside of God. I said the backside of God. The backside of God is the reflection of his glory. His face is the essence of his glory. And you and I can't handle his essence. So he said, I'm allowing you to see the reflection. The backside is enough for us to handle. He said, Moses, I can't show you everything because you wouldn't be able to survive everything. So I'm going to show you what you can see. We used to have what I call ghetto orange juice. That used to come in that little can that was frozen. Mm-hmm. And you had, that was called concentrate. You never opened that up and drank that. You had to mix it with a little water. Somebody ought to help me here. That right there is what you call the backside, because what happens in the backside is God takes his concentrated glory and he dilutes it a little bit in order to make it palatable to me. Touch somebody, tell him his backside is enough tonight. His backside is enough. I might not be able to always see his face. He tells Moses that I'm passing by, but you're only going to see my backside. His backside is limited, but it's all that Moses could survive. In his natural state, that's all that he could see. It was limited, but it was more than any other human had seen. Moses was dipping his cup down into the very sovereignty of God and pulling up as much as he could handle. And he was getting more than anybody else had gotten, but he was still skimming the surface himself. It says, Moses, this is enough for you. It's limited, but it is enough. It's enough because I know what you're about to deal with. And I know that you're about to go down a path that you've never been down. But tonight, you don't need to see my face, because my backside is enough. Oh yeah, my backside is not a sign of disrespect to you, but my backside is enough to empower you for what you are about to deal with. And that's all I'm trying to say. Only one little point of application, and that is for those of us who are involved in ministry. Every now and then you gotta take some time to spend some time at his feet. Because when you do, God will reveal his backside to you. And before you are productive in ministry, you need to see the glory of God, because the glory of God will empower you to deal with whatever you got to deal with. Somebody here has some stuff back home that you really don't want to face. Somebody has some stuff back home that you really don't want to deal with. But I tell you what you ought to do while you're at Oakwood. You ought to say, Lord, I need to see your glory. Lord, I'm coming to you with a bold request, because I need to see your glory. And when I have news for you, that when you request that from the Lord, that the Lord will show up. Do I have a witness here? The Lord will make his presence known. And when he makes his presence known, he will give you enough to make it. He will give you enough glory to make it. Somebody here needs to know that the Lord knows what you're facing. So he says, before you go out to the people, you need to come into me. Before you go out to the marketplace, you need to come into the secret place. Before you get on your feet, you need to get on your knees. Because on your knees, God will show you his backside. In worship, God will show you his backside. In prayer, God will show you his backside. Am I looking at anybody here? Has the Lord ever revealed his glory to you? Has the Lord ever revealed his backside to you? Do I have a witness here? And when the Lord shows you his backside, you'll be able to make it through whatever you got to make it through. Whatever it is, whatever you have to face, just go down on your knees and cry, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. Maybe you're not where I am, but if you're in my shoes, you're dealing with some stuff you've never dealt with. Do I have five people here who's dealing with something right now you've never dealt with? I tell you what you ought to do. go before the Lord and tell him, I don't need more money right now. I don't need more engagements right now. But what I need is to see your glory. Because if I can see your glory, I can make it through what I got to get through. I need a witness here. Come here, Stephen. Stephen said, when I was in the stoning pit and they were throwing the stones at me, I looked up to heaven and I saw the glory of God and I saw the Son of God. There's some glory you can't see until you're in the stoning pit. Do I have a witness here? Good day, church, and may the Lord bless you real good. Moses said, all I saw was the backside of God. In other words, what I saw was limited, but I praise God on tonight that in Jesus, we got a little bit more than God's backside, because Jesus said that when you see the Father, you see me. Jesus said that I and the Father are one. Do I have a witness here? I'm glad on tonight. I said, I'm glad on tonight. I wish I could holler here. I need somebody to holler with me. If you appreciate Jesus, if you appreciate what we have in the Christ, because in Christ, we get a better picture of who God is, but it's still limited because of the flesh, because even in Jesus, we still can't see the full picture because our flesh doesn't allow us too. But I heard Paul say that now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, I'm gonna see him. I'm gonna know him just as I'm known. One of these days, we're going to behold him. I said, we're going to behold him face to face. Is there anybody here who's looking forward to beholding him? I got to leave you now, but take your neighbor by the hand and tell him I'm looking forward to seeing him face to face. One of these days, the sky shall unfold. One of these days, the trump shall sound. And I'm going to see him face to face. I'm going to see him face to face. And I'm going to thank him for what he brought me through. Turn around and tell somebody, I'm going to give him glory for just his backside. One of these days, I'm going to praise him for face to face. But right now, tonight in Oakwood, I'm a praising for his backside. I got some hills to climb. I got some rivers to cross. I got some valleys to tunnel through. But I'm glad that I'm not by myself. I'm glad that his glory is real. I'm done with the sermon, but can I just celebrate Jesus? He's the one who woke me up this morning. He's the one put running in my feet. He's the one who put food on my table. Every time I think about him, I gotta give him glory. Every time I think about him, I gotta open up my mouth and tell him thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your power. I gotta leave you now, but take your neighbor by the hand and tell him I thank him for his presence. Because in the presence of the Lord is the fullness of joy. In the presence of the Lord. Is he all right? I said, is he all right? Is there anybody here who just wants to be in his presence? Is there anybody here who wants to be in his glory? Tell him right now, show me your glory. Tell him right now, show me your glory. I got some hills to climb. Show me your glory. I got some rivers to cross. Show me your glory. I got the devil in behind me. Show me your glory. I got bills to pay. Show me your glory. I got sickness in my body. Show me your glory. I got the hellhounds on my trail. Show me your glory. your glory. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, come on tonight. If you were blessed by that word, put your hands together and thank God for the backside of God. We thank God for the message and the messenger. Certainly we have been blessed. Listen, just very quickly, as we get ready to close, the following announcements. Dr. Gloria Bell will be meeting with all Bible workers at 3 p.m. tomorrow. In Mosley Chapel, all Bible workers meeting with Dr. Gloria Bell tomorrow at 3 p.m. in Mosley Chapel. All of the regional conference secretaries, you are asked to meet immediately following this worship experience in the Mosley Chapel as well. And on tomorrow morning, somebody say tomorrow morning.